weeping is because those that were his did not discern him. So again, let me clearly say something, that we're not just talking about what most people call discerning of spirits. Certainly that can be included, but we're not talking about one of the nine gifts of the Spirit necessarily. We're talking about having a discerning heart. We're talking about being in proximity to the Lord, whereby there are things that you know not because you know. Amen? The difference being, Song of Solomon, the Shulamite may have heard in the first chapter that the king is a good man and he's a loving man. Amen? Amen? She may have heard such things, that he is a king of love. But when he took her into his chamber, she understood love that passes understanding. Amen? There was something beyond just a mental perceiving of the facts that I must stand on, build my doctrinal issues upon, and proceed on. No, she was in love with the Lord, if you will, and had known that love. Discernment is, and all things are the same in the sense that they don't just come by gift, by God just casting something down upon us and hitting us with it, and certainly people are gifted and things like that. But my point is that the abundance of all of this comes by life. The abundance of all things comes by life, and that life is Christ. And our proximity to that life, our union as branch into that life, that's where it comes from. It's not going to come from, you know, chasing after the next revival, or it's going to come after chasing after Jesus. And the heart of the Lord isn't that we waste all of our time chasing after the next revival or conference or teaching or the next wave. You know, God's not into surfing. He's into relationship, okay? And so he's above the seas and above the heavens. I don't want to take away from those things as much as I want to lift Christ out above those things. That's my desire. No desire to put anything down. I want us to realize that Christ is far above all things. God raised him there, and he raised us up in him there. It is imperative that these be not doctrines, but that they actually become issues from which our issue comes from which we issue forth, from which whatever it is that we are comes forth. From this great river, you know, we're not trying to get in the river of God. We're trying to get the river of God to flow out of us. Amen. We're in it if we're in Him. Here in verse 41, and when he was come near, he beheld the city and wept over it. And so you see the heart of the Lord. You don't just see a doctrine. See the heart of the Lord. What is the issues here? Say it. He wept over it. Say it. He wept over it. He wept. Okay, Jesus wept several times throughout the scriptures. They were not small things. They may be small things to us. They were not small things to him. They drove him to tears. They are more than head things to him. They are heart things. Saying, if thou hadst known, even thou, at least in this thy day, the thing which belongeth unto thy peace, but now they are hidden from thine eyes. For the day shall come upon thee that thine enemies shall cast a trench about thee and compass thee about, and keep thee in on every side, shall lay thee even to the ground, and thy children within thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another, because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. And of course, it wasn't just a timing thing. And then Jesus had come other scriptures that tell the same story in Matthew and whatever, said, I would have gathered you. My heart is to gather you. And certainly we are gathered together in one. The dispensation before us at times that all things might be gathered together in one. That gathering is not gathering in a church building. That gathering is gathered together in Him, joined to Him, vine and branch, whereby we become truly the body of Christ, the vehicle of His expression. Instead, they did not discern this one, Jesus, above all else. They didn't discern that. Two, they didn't discern His purpose wasn't just to liberate the Jews from Rome. It was to liberate the Jews from themselves and bring them into Him as their fullness. And they didn't discern the time. There were so many levels. There are many levels we need to learn to discern on. And I realize that we have a room full of young people and everything, and some of this comes with time. But never let that be an excuse and say, okay, well, I'll have to, you know, when I'm old and ugly like Randy, maybe I'll get smart. You know, trust me, I'm old and ugly and I'm not smart yet. So it has nothing to do with brains. It has everything to do, again, with proximity to the Lord. With being overcome and overwhelmed by Him that is all. You hear the Bible writers talk about the Lord being awe-inspiring. Few of us have been awe-inspired. and that's what He does when you truly see Him. He shuts all mouths, and He is all and in all. At that point, we begin to comprehend that. The Lord came back not to persecute, to punish, to, you know, He came back to gather us and to give unto us the things that are prepared for our peace. And resurrection, His words regularly to those that He loved, fear not, peace. And it wasn't just a Jewish slogan, shalom. Wasn't what He was saying. He was telling us that the bridge between us and Him is gone by virtue of His death and resurrection, and let us rush quickly in and lay hold of all that He is, of all the root and fatness of the Bible. So what a heart-rendering thing to Him when, you know, it's the thought that I think of is an old saying or book or something a long time ago I read that says that something like the prison door is open and we're still sitting on the inside. It's like we've been in there so long that even opening the door, we just kind of look around and go, well, this is my dwelling. I'm a prisoner. You see, we have become a prisoner without bars. We have become limited without bars. And the truth is that He has broken down the middle wall of partition. He has broken down all bars. And you say, but I don't sense that. I don't feel that. I feel bound in many areas. The answer is not so much for Him to get you free as for you to recognize the freedom that is yours. Embrace that. You say, but how can I embrace something that is not true? No, you're already doing that. You've succeeded in doing that, and that is you're embracing your bondage when it's not true. You're well adapted to embracing something that's not true. What you need to do is move out and embrace what is true and what eternally will be true. And it only has to be accepted by our faith in the finished work of the cross. And glorious things are spoken of her. And you will rejoice when you understand. You will rejoice. You will shout for joy when you understand. understand that, and you are yet waiting for God to do something, and it's like a chess game. He made the last move. It's called the cross and the resurrection. It's your move. We're saying it's not going to happen. So anyway, let's turn over to Matthew chapter 16. Pick this scripture particularly because Matthew is here, and I wanted to, you know, I'm really supporting you. Matthew 16, beginning of verse 1. The Pharisees with the Sadducees came and testing him. Now, just to pop your little bubble, if Christ is going to be your life, Christ is going to be your life, then he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen? You agree with that? You agree he's the same yesterday? Well, guess what? You are going to be tested by people who don't like you and don't believe you. And don't. Your goal is to not live by what's down here, but by every word you're said by the mouth of the Father. Your goal is to separate from this wilderness and live in a good land. That's your goal. One of the things that I've been contemplating a lot lately, and that is, because this is a wilderness, this is the place that rejected Jesus. This is the place that rejected the one that is my all, that I love with all my heart. This wilderness down here rejected me. I don't know what that means to you, but it means a lot. Show them a sign from heaven. Oh yeah, where are they living at? Earth. They want a sign from heaven. Jesus is. Why would anybody foolishly do that when all we have to do is look into the fullness and go, forget the sign, you are all in all, you are all that I need, and I am content with you. But you see, if we only see the Nazarene or the prophet or even the Redeemer, because the Redeemer is not the fullness, or he just redeems. You have to know him in all of his relationships, all of his names, all of that, and come into that with the Lord. So there's much growth yet, amen? And how are we going to discern without some growth? You know, that's the goal. We grow up in him in all things. You don't just grow up. You don't just grow in spiritual facts. You grow up in him in all things. And so he answered and said unto them, when it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and overcast. O ye hypocrites, you can discern the face of the sky, but can you not discern the signs of the time? So here he is saying that you have learned discernment on the earth level, on a meteorological level. Your discernment is excellent. But on a spiritual level, he said, you don't even know what's going on. And they didn't. Scribes and Pharisees and Sadducees had no clue what was going on. This was an eternal time. This was an eternal moment. God had come in the flesh, dwelt among them. You couldn't get much closer to God. Nobody went like that. I mean, you know, reach out. He's right there. Yet they had no clue. Not only had no clue, but was resisting him. Okay? We're talking about zero discernment. And all of the meteorological discernment in the world will not help you to know Christ. Discernment on two levels. Discernment by Christ and discernment by the Holy Spirit. The first one being discernment by Christ, which is where you know what to do, not because you have the facts, or you have an explanation from God in answer to your prayers. But in the example that I've used, I think last week when I shared, maybe I did, when the two disciples were on the road to Emmaus, and they're walking along, and Jesus had been crucified, and they were concerned, and they were confused. What's going on here? And, you know, we're talking about the cross and the resurrection, and that's what they talked about. Well, you know, they crucified him, but we certain women had told us that he'd been, you know, they got all the facts. And I'm just here to tell you, the facts aren't enough. The facts will not get you through. So what made the difference? Then drew near to them Jesus. Amen? And the story changed. Instead of being two men who finally made it to Emmaus, two men who talked about God and went to Emmaus. That would have been the end of that story if Jesus hadn't drawn near. Jesus is the discernment of the events of the scriptures. I'm still talking Luke 24. He is the discernment of the events that took place. He is the discernment of the scriptures. He is the discernment of that very moment. He is the discernment of all things. When Christ draws near, when he is presented and by life, then we know what to do. And the example that I gave was Jesus then appeared to them and then showed himself and then he disappeared. And they immediately left, and instead of going on to Emmaus, they immediately returned to Jerusalem, showed up in the same room where Jesus appeared next. And Jesus never told them that he was going to Jerusalem. How did that happen? You are so overwhelmed with the one that you see that it's not just you see something over there and you know it. What you see is like light that permeates your whole being. And you are putting on the armor of life. You are being clothed with Christ. You're not just learning facts and drawing, well, I know this scripture. Yeah. But Christ has permeated your being, and now all of a sudden, where he appears, you appear. Nobody has to tell you. Nobody has to give you the Ten Commandments or the 25 rules of how to get along at Acts Bible School. You are there where Christ is because you have become joined. You have become one. Not just spiritually, theologically. Everybody's born spiritually, theologically, and live contrary and run 100 different directions like those chicks that I would have gathered, but no, you're all running crazy. That was the example Jesus used when he went over to Jerusalem. No, it's not mass chaos, confusion, it is clarity. He said, I'm talking about this evening. The bride descends, having the glory of God. In the original Greek there, it is having the clarity of God. But when you look at the bride, or you look at someone who has been with the Lord in that way, you do not see a glow coming off of them. But what you might see is the clarity of God in them. They see. They see. You may look around and say, not too many people here do see. That one has the clarity of God. What is that? It's not you. I don't need to tell you that, right? You and I are ignorant savages. That we are. And given the right opportunity, we will not only prove ignorance, but savagery. That's true. Every one of us. What is our hope? Christ, that we might be conformed to the image of Christ, that he might be all and in all, that his clarity might be worked in us, permeating in us to such a degree that the blind man, Jesus comes to him, what do you want? That I may see. Eyes are open. What are you looking at? Jesus. That's seeing. We say, oh, Jesus opened his eyes and now he can see trees and grass and what a happy moment. No, the true opening of his eyes, when his eyes were open, he's seeing Jesus. That's true seeing. Now you have clarity. This, and of course, this is John 9 I'm talking about. I realize I share a lot of scripture without telling you where it's from. But in John chapter 9, the man was blind, born blind. And he thought he saw. He thought he discerned, or in one sense, maybe he thought he didn't. Maybe he thought he was alone before he was in the eyes were open. I'm alone, and everybody else sees, and I am one who is in darkness. But what did Jesus say at the end of that whole chapter after he opened the man's eyes? Jesus said to the Pharisees and everybody else, he says, if you say you see, you're blind. And they got upset and said, what are you saying? Are you saying we're blind? Yes, I'm saying that you're blind. And the blind man realized when his eyes were open that he hadn't been alone and a blind man in the midst of this society that sees. He realizes that they were all blind. And now he is alone in the midst of this wilderness. But he is not alone. He is not truly alone. He is separated, but not alone. What do you mean by that? Well, we'll look at Jesus. Jesus hunted him down. Jesus spent time communing with him. Jesus explained himself to him. Jesus showed himself to him. Jesus. And the man stood, and this is a, I thought, an important issue. The man stood when few ever in this whole book ever stood up for Jesus and said, look, get off his back. He had to do that for Mary, got Martha, but few stood up for him. Well, he doesn't need it. He's the Son of God. I don't think he needs it on the level we would need it, but I think he might need it on the level of he came for a bride. The one coming back in the air, the bridegroom. We forget that. That's what he's coming back for. And that's what that's all about. That's what he's come for. And this man saw, and they said, they pulled him into the synagogue and grilled him one after another. And they, one way that you are grilling somebody is when you keep asking the same questions over and over. And that's what they did to this man. He said, you already asked me that, and I told you. Will you be his followers also? No, will not be. This man's a sinner. Da, da, da. And, he said, look, I don't know much. But I don't want to. I was blind, now I see. Okay? And this man did. So get That was, if you read it, I mean, it's basically, he stood up for the Lord and said, I don't care what you think. Well, what happened after that? Well, Jesus hunted the man down. I like that. You know, most of the time people were hunting Jesus down. They were chasing after him, pulling on him, grabbing and trying to get to him, and ripping roofs off and everything else. Just, you know, you don't see a whole lot of time where he starts hunting somebody down, but he hunted this man down. And further showed himself and explained himself. Now, this man was no longer alone. He thought he had been alone all of his life in darkness as a blind man, only to have his eyes open and realize, good grief, we were all blind. Only to have Christ more fully reveal himself so that he understood, I am separate from this world and I am not alone. And that's a glorious thing. Trust me, the man was okay. The Pharisees and everyone else were the ones that continued to have the acid eating the inside of their stomach line. There is peace, and he is your peace when you have come into that sort of a union, that sort of an embrace. And so Jesus just says, you don't discern, you don't know. And there is this discernment that few seem to have, that all, and I'm just going to throw out a few quick things here on discernment that are, the Holy Spirit brings up, actually. When you talk about discernment, most of the time there's only one thing people talk about, and that is the discerning of spirits. Discerning of spirits. Did you know that there is a huge truth in relationship to discerning the body of Christ? Did you know that you can't even actually have communion without discerning the body of Christ? Oh, well, you can, sip a little wine and eat a little bread. They don't give you enough to fill you up. So you really haven't accomplished a whole lot. There is a discernment to this whole thing. And it was written to people who went to church and went through the ritual to whom Paul said, you don't even discern the body of Christ. One over here eating and taking for himself, and another one doing without, and this one that, and this one going that way, and again, I see the chips running everywhere. Not gathered in one. For that he may be all, and we are members of one, and one is sin, not for many. But I am a finger in the body of Christ, through that I exist for the purpose of expressing one. Amen?
Amen.
Which is greater, your house or you? Never mind, can't ask that. Can't ask that in America. Well, Hebrews says it, and says the owner of the house is greater than the house. So, there is discernment in relationship to the body of Christ, which is discerned by Christ. Many of us around here are being schooled in the ability to function by discerning by Christ. Some are actually able to do that. Because the issues ultimately are light and darkness, life and death, Christ and everything that's not Christ. That's a fact. I mean, I don't know how much we realize that, but that's the absolute truth. So discernment in this area is paramount. It must take place. It must be, or we are blown by the wind of doctrine. No discernment, just we're either fighting or running after something. We have no control over our own selves. They're just whatever, we're just trying to find our way. Let me tell you something, I'm not trying to find my way. I found the way. His name is Jesus. scriptures and it has nothing to do with you unless you're a liar.
No, I'm sorry.
I just keep whittling this group down. What's your calling, Randy? Conform the image of Christ and with you. I really have no desire to live. At one time in my walk, I did. I have only a desire to lift up Christ. That tends to win. There is. Lying is all comes in all kind of forms, folks. It's not just, you know, I took a bath today, and you didn't. We know. I discern that you're lying. We got to get, you know, we got to come on a different level than that. You know what I'm saying? We've got to get a hold of this thing much, much deeper. You know? Well, you know, when the guy walked in, he had a wild look. Oh, look at that. Wild look. You know, I think that you can sometimes look in somebody's eyes and go, whoa! You got some fellas in there, don't you? And I believe that that can happen. But I'm telling you that we shouldn't walk by sight.
Yeah.
Even if we know through that method, that is not the method that we're supposed to know by. That's important. That's not small. You say, but at least I'm not deceived. I know. No, you are deceived because you know by the senses. Stop it. You say, well, you know, but then I'll just be an ignorant savage and everybody will eat my lunch. No, what you do is you say, Lord, I want to see by your eyes. I want, what is it? What is that scripture in, what is it? Proverbs or Psalms? And I'm sorry, I can't remember the, it says, thou wilt guide me by thine eye. That means his view, his seeing. We don't see. He doesn't make us seers. That time has passed. Now Christ is the fullness of all things. He does better than make us seers. We see by his, not even by his knowledge, but by light reacting to darkness. Can anybody understand that? That is so important. You know, I have no clue why but I think this is the Lord. Yeah. Now, I even hesitate to say this, because, you know, I'm going to start running around going, I think I discern that you're, and I don't want to unleash that kind of stuff. You know, we got enough problems right here. We're not the perfect group. Remind me. What is it? Okay, we need to look at that because it goes on to say, what is it, Psalm 32:8? Is that Old or New Testament? Give us a different. Psalm 32:8, is that what you said? That's not my Psalm 32. 32:8. Is that okay? I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way which thou shalt go. I will guide thee with mine eye. Get ready. There's more. Be not like the horse or the mule. That's right. Don't be a jackass. That have no understanding, whose mouth must be held in with bit and bridle lest they come near. So he's saying, don't be where I have to ride you and pull this way, and say, oh, go this way, oh, go that way. He's saying, I want to guide you with mine eye. I want to be on the inside of you. I want you on the inside of me. I want your discernment to come by union, not by bit and bridle, go here, go there. Well, I'm just asking the will of the Lord. I only want to go the way the Lord wants. What do you want me to do? Go this way. Go this way. Oh, stop. Look. You know, those things were made for donkeys. information about that. Do one thing for me, please. At the end of this class, in your little convenient time, just ask the Lord to increase the discernment, both of my Christ and of the Holy Spirit. That's all. And then trust that He'll do that. That's all. That's all that's required. My explanation to talking about it is not going to enlighten you, to bring you into great. No, the Holy Spirit will do that. And all you got to do is just say, hey, that's good. I would really like to be more discerned. Because most of you are going to continue in the Lord and ministry and serving others the rest of your life. Amen? Unless you don't have much other plans. So it's good, you know, when you walk out of here, I'd like you to have all sorts of, you know, bazookas and, you know what I mean? You know, instead of going out here, don't really just a dumb, you know, what was that?
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
And I'll just close with this. You know, Denise and I don't have this too. Most of you know I was raised under a man who was a very, very hard man, especially at the time, more so than now. God used all of that, helped me. And I'm just the opposite, but I'm the kind of person that will mess with some of you. You know, you won't like this or that or whatever. It'll, you know. You have to learn to hear the word of God that's coming forth and ignore the vessel. It would be ideal if we all were so conformed to the image of Christ that you didn't have to discern or wean your soul. I'm of Apollos because I like the way Apollos presents stuff. I won't listen to Paul. Well, that would be a tragedy. Amen? That would be a tragedy. And there were a lot of people who didn't like Paul. Did you know that? He's more popular today than he was before. That's the truth. He is way more popular. Well, Paul, even back then, they're like, Paul. Really? Oh, yeah. You know, I can't wait till I die. I think it's popular, at least accepted. When we come back, I think that we're going to pick up where we left off last class, and that was we were going through the test. Remember the test of job security, the test of menial tasks. We're going to continue with some of those tests. And be sure to pray that little prayer. It doesn't have to take long. Pray that little prayer before you rush back to the snack. All right.